Good morning, everyone. A warm welcome to dear Smita Mathai ma'am, the resource person of the day, and dear principals as well as my dear teachers. We have ended the sixth day of the webinar, which has been conducted by MGM Group of Institutions. 4 days were dedicated for pre-primary, and 1 day was for the training of the principals as well as vice presidents of our schools. Today we have a webinar on English language teaching, how it can be done online. I request Neelam Rathwaran from MGM Korba to accord a word of welcome.
Very good morning to one and all. I am Mrs. Neelam Rathwar from MGM Balkonagar Korba. Honorable President Sir Diocesan St. Thomas Mission Education Board, His Grace Dr. Joseph Mar Dionysius, Metropolitan Calcutta Diocese, respected principals of various schools under MGM Group, Reverend Father Dr. Joshi Varghese, our resource person for today's webinar, Ms. Smita Mathai ma'am, and dear teachers, it's my privilege to welcome you all to this special webinar for English language teaching organized by MGM Group of Institutions, St. Thomas Mission Education Board, Bhilai. The mission has successfully completed a webinar cum orientation program for pre-primary teachers also, which is highly appreciated and fruitful with numerous positive feedbacks. The whole world is facing a tough time today due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Situation is getting worse day by day. Due to lack of any medicine or vaccine, only social distancing has become the essential norm to be followed by everyone to fight against the spread of COVID-19. Likewise, a complete lockdown was imposed by the central and various state governments. And now, it's the phase of unlocking. But there is a warning against the reopening of schools and various educational institutions, as it is quite difficult to follow social distancing in these areas, due to which the teaching learning process is greatly being affected. In this fearful scenario, only teaching will not suffice. Instead, we the teachers have to spread awareness in society through our students. So it's high time to get ourselves updated and use the technology for virtual teaching sessions. The objective of this webinar is to enhance our skills on digital platform so that with better and innovative ideas we will be able to impart knowledge to our students efficiently during this pandemic. May I take the pride to introduce the resource person for today's webinar, Ms. Smita Mathai ma'am. Welcome ma'am. For the last 25 years she has been associated with various educational institutions conducting workshops, subject-specific workshops for teachers, workshops on parenting styles for parents, and various workshops for all age group of students, starting from pre-primary to high school. We are privileged enough that we are a part of this webinar and going to be benefited due to her rich and varied experience. Without much delay, I would like to end my words. Once again, a very warm welcome to all. Together we can, together we will. So let's begin. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. I invite Smita Mathai ma'am to take over.
Thank you, Father, and thank you, Ms. Neelam, for the warm welcome and the lovely introduction. Good morning, dear teacher. A very, very warm welcome to all of you. It's exciting. I've been through so many webinars being organized by the MNR Group of Schools, Institutes. Fantastic that even through the lockdown period, even through the COVID-19 situation, the MGM Group is reaching out to its teachers, to its principals, vice principals, and through these various webinars, doing everything possible to empower the different members of the teaching fraternity. It's a fantastic effort, and I'm sure all of us are going to do everything possible to the best of our capacity to ensure that we make a success of this entire situation. I'm going to start sharing my screen. stay with me for a few minutes while the screen switches so that you can see my presentation. Yeah. Father, if you could just confirm, is my presentation visible to all?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes. Thank you. Thank you. So we're going to be looking at English language teaching. Excuse me. We're also looking at the major skills that we need to develop in students when we are teaching them the English language. Before I get into the session, just a few gentle reminders for all of us. Since we've all logged into this webinar from our homes, teachers request you all to find a quiet corner so that the distraction is minimal. I understand we've all logged in from our homes, hence there are a lot of things happening around us. But the next 1.5 hour, let us try and isolate ourselves so that we can give 100% to this session. Also, please set your audio on mute all times. Check it time to time, because I know some of you have logged in from your mobile phone. Sometimes, you know, by mistake, your audio might just get unmuted. So just keep checking. We are around 175 people who are logged in right now as I speak to you. So to make sure that the webinar goes on smoothly without too many hitches, it's important that the others keep their mics on mute, but that does not mean you are gagged. Please remember, you will be constantly communicating with me. Use the chat box on the right-hand corner of the screen. You will see the chat box. Please use the chat box to constantly communicate with me. Do not feel gagged. You can use the chat box to give me your suggestions, your opinions, your thoughts. Also, I'm going to be constantly questioning you. Use the chat box to give me your answers. Please ensure you have a pen and a notepad. We will be doing activities for which you will need to use a notepad and pen. So while I'm giving you the other points on the webinar etiquette, you can quickly go around and find yourselves a notepad and pen. Also remember, teachers, the chat box is publicly visible. So kindly keep your contributions helpful and considerate of the host and the other participants. At the end of the webinar, please stick around for another 5-10 minutes to leave your feedback in the chat box. What do you think about the webinar? What are your takeaways from the webinar? What did you like about the webinar? And what did you not like about the webinar? All of this in the chat box. Yes? All right, now let's begin without any more delay so that I can stick to the time frame and end by 11:15 so that we have the last 15 minutes for question answer and feedback. So let's begin with the first activity. You have to start typing in true or false to the first statement that you see on your screen. And the first statement is, it is impossible to teach English to beginners without using the mother tongue. All English teachers, I understand you're teachers of different grades. Do you think it is impossible to teach English to beginners without using mother tongue? Please answer in true or false. Yes and no can be confusing. Okay, Sadaf says false, Sajita is saying false. Okay, it is impossible to teach English. So when you say false, you're saying it is possible to teach English. So are we not using any other language in our English class? Do we never succumb to the local language? Do we never succumb? Do we never use the mother tongue in the local language? We do. Yes, Sadaf, you said the first statement is false. yet you're saying, yes, we do use the mother tongue in the class. So does it become impossible to teach English without using mother tongue then? Think about it. Okay, I have some of you saying true. It is impossible to teach English to beginners without using the mother tongue. So now I have a mixed slot of answers, some true and some false. Okay, lots of truths also coming in. We do. Yes, and a lot of you are saying we do use the mother tongue in the class. Okay, let's look at the second statement. I will give you the answers shortly. Let's look at the second statement. We should never use the mother tongue in an English lesson. Is that true or false? Never use the mother tongue in an English lesson. Okay. So again, it's a mix of true, false. Okay. So if you say false to the second one, automatically your first statement becomes true. If you say we should never use mother tongue in an English lesson as false, then your first statement, it's impossible to teach English, becomes true because you're using mother tongue in an English class. Okay, a lot of you are saying false now, never use mother tongue in an English class. All right. Anything never is false. Okay. Using only English in class will scare our learners. Okay, I have one response here by Miss Reddy, and he says it depends. Okay. All right, using only English in class will scare our learners. Some of you are saying true. A lot of you are saying false. True, false. Sometimes it may scare, okay. All right, so let me tell you what brain studies have shown in this matter. When you teach language, and according to scientists who've done a lot of study and put together a lot of statistical information on all these three statements, it is impossible to teach English to beginners without using mother tongue is false. Ideally, we should teach English to beginners without using the mother tongue, and I'll explain to you why. The reason we say never use another language to teach a new language, another known or familiar language to teach new language, is because when you're teaching a new language, the minute you use another language, the brain is only listening to the familiar language. The brain is not processing the foreign language and making an association and assimilation of the language. Yes, while the brain is a very smart and the most complex human organ, it is also the laziest human organ. The reason being, the minute the brain is able to understand something that's familiar, it does not make an attempt to grasp what is unfamiliar. And I'll show you an example by demonstration. The minute I say, I tell everybody, if I want to teach you a foreign language, okay, and I say untule, materla untule. When I do this action and I'm saying untule, materla untule, what do you understand? Very good, Miss Sajita. Excellent. Get up. Yes. Now the minute I have not said yes, thank you, Miss Preeti. Thank you, Nilanjana has got it right on the, it's a bullseye. Umtule means stand, right? Now, had I told you all, Umtule, stand up, the brain has immediately picked up stand up, understood stand up and done the action. But it has not made an attempt to associate my action with the word and made a registration of Untule is stand up. It does not cause permanent learning. Hence, when you teach English language, you have to teach English language in the language itself without using the mother tongue. So, which makes the second statement, we should never use mother tongue in an English lesson, true. We shouldn't use the mother tongue in an English lesson if we expect students to associate, assimilate the English language in their heads and to be able to recall and reuse the vocabulary. Using only English in class will scare our learners. It will not. As long as I keep smiling, as long as I'm keeping eye contact, as long as I'm encouraging my students by giving them a positive nod each time I'm speaking to them and they are making attempts to respond to me. Yes, so we have to make sure that our body language, our facial expressions are in sync with what we are doing, what we are saying, what we are teaching. And also keep in mind to encourage our learners, we have to maintain the friendly approach, the encouraging approach, so that students courageously learn to respond back in English. Okay? All right, so this is about teaching the English language. How do we do it? We do it by using only English in our classes. Avoid using the mother tongue. I do understand sometimes we have to bring in some amount of the mother tongue. Although studies definitely point out as a complete no-no to the mother tongue, you have to break down your instructions as much as possible to simple language, to a lot of body language. Also use flashcards, use images, use realia, use pictures, use videos, and encourage children to use the English language. Now, when we are teaching English language, what are the skills that we focus on? Think about when you learned a language, any language, how did you learn it? How do all of us learn any language? When we are little babies, when we are born into our families, how do we pick up the mother tongue, the language being spoken by the family? What are the different ways? What are the ways we learn language? Can you use the chat box, teachers, to please put down your responses? How do we learn language? Yes, by listening. Very good. So the first time we learn is by listening, by actions, right? And then what is the next thing we do? Those of you who have little children at home, little babies at home, I'm sure a lot of us here are parents also. So when our children are, yes, then you start speaking. Very good. Yes, Miss. Absolutely right, Miss Chitra. Practicing. Yes, Anurag. Gestures. We learn by listening, by speaking. So if I asked you to list all the skills by speaking short sentences, absolutely right, Ms. Asta. By speaking short sentences, by touching an object and naming it, right, Ms. Sujata? Yes, Ms. Lindsay, by watching others at home, responding to words. Excellent. So we are learning by listening, by speaking. What else? When we come to school and we learn the English language, what are the other skills we are teaching our students? We teach them to speak English, listen. Yes, absolutely right. Marin, we are teaching them to read. What else do we do? Absolutely right. Reading and writing. So the main skills for teaching a language are listening, speaking, reading, writing. And you also have some sub-skills, which are vocabulary, punctuation, dictionary work, spellings, pronunciation, stress, intonation, and grammar. Absolutely right, Ms. Ruhi, Gurpreet, Shibani, LSRW, we are looking at the four major skills which commonly known among English teachers as LSRW. In sub-skills, we are doing vocabulary, punctuation, dictionary work, spellings, pronunciation, stress, intonation, and grammar. I'm going to take up each of these skills and see how we can, Ms. Tripti is rightly saying, how we can make the content interesting and involve all students. Like right now, we have 191 participants in this session. While it may seem, oh my God, 190 people, how are we going to keep this interactive? Even in an online class, when I'm teaching language, I can make it interactive by using the chat box. And I'm going to show you how this is possible. When I take you through each of the skills, and you're going to use the chat box to communicate with me, to interact with me. So let's start with the first skill that we use in the classroom. And the first skill is listening in the classroom. So how often are children listening to us in the classroom? Can you put it in the chat box? When do children listen to you? Supposing you have a 40-minute class, how much of the time is spent in listening by the students? Yes, how much of the time we tell a story? Children listen to us when we tell a story. Yes, Ms. Sajita, 15 to 20 minutes. Yes, Eugene, we make it interesting when we are doing, when we are talking something interesting, they listen to us. When we use visual pictures, they listen to us. When we tell them about an incident, they listen to us. Real life incidents, yes, Gurpreet. So when you share, especially English teachers, when you share something from your personal lives, for example, when I am doing a listening activity in class, I have observed children listen up, sit up the minute I share something from my life. The minute I start saying, oh, you know what happened today when I was coming to school? So I come walking to school, and when I was walking down to school, I saw, and immediately children have their attention. Yes, absolutely right, Chitra. It is when they find something interesting. When we do activities, absolutely right, Sachin. When we do activities also, they are listening to us. In an online class, how do I ensure everybody is listening to me? I keep calling out, reading out what's in the chat box. I keep calling out to names. Yes, Miss Shiny. When I involve all the children, they listen to me. How do I involve everybody? By calling out their names. Right now, as I call out your names, you are excited about being part of this online webinar. You are, you know, really trying hard to type out fast. When you hear me call out to someone's name, yes, Sangeeta, by questioning, absolutely right. You want your name also to be called out. It's a absolutely normal human tendency. We want to be recognized for the work we are doing. It's the same with our students. When you do an online class, respond to what comes up in the chat box. Maintain decorum by keeping the audio on mute as much as possible. If you have a smaller group, yes, they can unmute and give their responses. But in a large group, it's useful to use the chat box. Ms. Reena, if you're not able to see the video, do not worry. So long as you can see the PowerPoint on your screen and you can hear me, it's possible that your internet connectivity is slow and hence the video has gone off. You could also try logging out and logging in again. All right, let's get on. So I'm going to do a listening activity with you teachers, and I want you to all respond to it like students of class 5, because I'm going to do a poetry reading. I'm going to read out a poem to you. And this is a poem from the Magnolia textbook of class 5. You're not going to see the poem. You don't have the books. you only have to listen to me very carefully, and because, and I say you have to listen to me carefully and attentively, because at the end of my reading, I'm going to ask you some really interesting questions. All right? So listen attentively. Don't try taking down the poem. It's not going to be very useful. Listen attentively and recall when I ask you the questions. The poem I'm reading out is from the textbook Magnolia by Orion Black Swan. It's a class 5 book. From a Railway Carriage by Robert Louis Stevenson. Faster than fairies, faster than witches, bridges and houses, hedges and ditches, and charging along like troops in a battle, all through the meadows, the horses and cattle. All the sights of the hill and plain fly as thick as driving rain. And ever again, in the wink of an eye, painted stations whistle by. Here is a child who clambers and scrambles all by himself and gathering brambles. Here is a tramp who stands and gazes, and there is the green for stringing the daisies. Here is a cart run away in the road, humping along with man and load. And here is a mill, and there is a river, each a glimpse and gone forever. I hope all of you were able to listen to this poem. And some of you who are saying audio is not clear, please log out and log in again. But I'm hoping for a majority of us, the audio is clear. It depends on your network connectivity. Okay, for those who heard the audio clearly, how many things does the poet see from the railway carriage? My question to you teachers, how many things did the poet see from his railway carriage? So give me a number quickly in the chat box. Can you recall? Were you paying attention? Were you attentive? Can you recall how many things the poet saw from his railway carriage? Okay, 3, 4, 5, rivers, bridge. Do not name the things. Just give me a number. Meadows, bridges. You're like giving me, no, I want how many, okay? I think Eugene said 12. Most of you are stuck between 5, 6, 7. They're all incorrect answers. So what do we do now? Sadaf, what would you suggest I do? I'm not getting the right answers. Do you all have any suggestions, teachers? Do you all have any suggestions? Okay, I have a very good suggestion by Anupriya and Taranjeet. Repeat the poem again. All right, reread, read again. Please repeat. Okay, I'm doing that. Okay, I'm reading the poet. I'm reciting the poem again. All right, teachers. Yes, I am repeating. Can you please reread? All right. Okay. So, all ears again, pay attention. From a Railway Carriage by Robert Louis Stevenson. Faster than fairies, faster than witches, bridges and houses, hedges and ditches, and charging along like troops in a battle, all through the meadows, the horses and cattle. All the sights of the hill and plain fly as thick as driving rain. And ever again, in the wink of an eye, painted stations whistle by. Here is a child who clambers and scrambles all by himself and gathering brambles. Here is a tramp who stands and gazes, and there is the green for stringing the daisies. Here is a cart run away in the road, humping along with man and load. And here is a mill, and there is a river, each a glimpse and gone forever. Okay, my question to you is, what is the railway carriage being compared to? What is the railway carriage being compared to? Okay, I have some answers. 10, 19, 19. Oh my God. Yes, Ruhi. I have changed my question. Yes, Sangeeta, it's compared to fairies and witches. I changed my question. Yes. All right. Painted stations. 25 plus. Okay. Haha, ma'am, we were focusing on finding the number of things he sees. Yes. Now, this is the trick. When you want students to listen to you attentively, you do something interesting like this. You read a poem the first time, you ask them a really simple question. How many things did you see? So the children who weren't even paying attention the first time, when they hear the other students calling out numbers, they're wondering, oh, this is easy. Let me pay attention. And when the first set of students tell you to ask you to repeat the poem again, the second time when you recite the poem, everybody is paying attention because they are counting on their fingers the number of things. Now, when I change the question, oh, this is an interesting game. She's changed the question. Now, do you want me to read the poem again? 99% of the time, your students will again ask you to read the poem. Again, you read it a third time. I can change the question again. I say, okay, how many, what were the man-made things seen by the poet? Yes. Now, again, they are like, you immediately get some answers from them because they've heard the poem three times and they're able to do a whole lot of recall. Okay. I would have loved to take this whole activity through by throwing different questions at you, showing you different ways how you can grab their attention. But time is not going to permit me to do that because I have a whole lot of other skills also to touch upon. But I will quickly show you the number of things the poet saw. So you can count the red boxes that are there on the screen. Those of you who said 21, you counted all the nouns that kept coming up in the poem. But those were not the things the poet saw from the railway carriage. He was even comparing the rail, he was even comparing the train to a lot of other things. But the things he actually saw from the window were bridges, houses, hedges, ditches, horses, cattle, hill, plain, painted station, a child, brambles, tramp, green, that's the grass that he saw, cart, man, lord, river, mill. So he saw 18 things from the railway carriage. And what is the train compared to? It is faster than fairies, faster than witches, like troops in a battle, thick as driving rain, in the wink of an eye. Okay, I have a request from Pradeep to zoom my screen. Let me try doing that. I can't go any larger than that, because I will not be able to change my slide and see the chat window. I need to keep my presentation window max to this size if I have to keep my eye on the chat box, because it's important for me to be communicating and interacting with all of you. So this is how I make it interesting to ensure students are listening to me. I can teach various poetic devices in this listening activity. What is it being compared to? In a poem, when you do comparisons, what is the figure of speech teachers we're going to get at? Faster than fairies, faster than witches, like troops in a battle. What are these? Absolutely right, Arnab. We're talking about the simile. When I say thick as driving rain, it's a simile. Okay, can someone tell me in the wink of an eye? Is also a figure of speech, in the wink of an eye. This is comparison without using as and like. So what is it? And now ever, yes, absolutely right, Ms. Chanda. It's a metaphor. I can move on to a whole lot of things using just a listening activity. Absolutely right. Let's look. So this one way of doing a listening activity is listen and recall, where I where I read out the poem number of times and get students to recall. Now, even if I go back here and I'm asking questions like, keep your eyes on the chat window and look at the amount of recall that you are all able to do, okay? Faster than dash, faster than dash. What is it? Give me the answer to the two dashes in the chat box. Let's see the recall of the poem that you all just heard. Absolutely right, Sadaf and Chanda, and Sajita and Ria and a whole lot of you. Faster than fairies, faster than... Yes, ma'am, request you put your answer in the chat box. I'm sorry, I know some of you have logged in from your mobile and sometimes it's difficult to type fast on the keypad because there's a whole rush for the right answers coming in. Charging along like dash in a battle. Miss Punyavati, it's okay, slow in typing. I completely understand. I'm sure all of you got the right answer there. Troops, yes, absolutely right. And ever again in the wink of an eye, dash, dash, whistle by. What is whistling by? Ever and ever again, yes, absolutely right. Painted stations. Yes, Sujit, Bindu, absolutely right. Painted stations. Thank you, friends. So this is how you can do a listen and recall. Recall again is the primary, the first. If you look, if you can all go back to all the things we learned during our BA, Bloom's taxonomy. The first skill, the first learning skill is recall and remember. So you start with that, then you move on to the higher order thinking skills. Listen and tabulate. Okay. Now I want you all to all, I'm going to read out the poem again. You need to use the chat box to list man-made things and things found in nature. Do not click on the send button till I finish reading the whole poem. In your chat box, first, let's only get the man-made things. What are the man-made things that the poet sees from the railway carriage? I'm going to read out the poem again. You will listen and type as I'm reading out the whole poem. Do not hit the send button. Do not press enter till I have finished reading the whole poem. And you've listed all the things that the poet sees from the railway carriage that are man-made. Okay? Get ready to start typing. Faster than fairies, faster than witches, bridges and houses, hedges and ditches. And charging along like troops in a battle, all through the meadows, the horses and cattle. All the sights of hill and plain, fly as thick as driving rain. And ever again in the wink of an eye, painted stations whistle by. Here is a child who clambers and scrambles, all by himself gathering brambles. Here is a tramp who stands and gazes, and there is the green for stringing the daisies. Here is a cart run away in the road, humping along with man and load. And here is a mill and there is a river, each a glimpse and gone forever. So now y'all can hit the send. Okay. Fantastic. Look at the chat box. It's kind of flying past. So I have a whole list of things. I'll read out Jesse's answer. Bridges and houses. Okay, the answer has flown by. Man-made things, houses, bridges, mills, painted station, cart. Okay, well done, teachers. Very good. Okay, bridges, houses, station, cart, road, ditches, hedges. Excellent. So do you see what's happening? Everyone is at 100% attention, quickly typing in all the man-made things. We can do a listen and tabulate. I can do this activity again. where I asked you to list the things found in nature. You have the poem again on your screens. The man-made things that the poet sees from his railway carriage are bridges, houses, hedges, ditches, painted stations, cart, load, and a mill. Okay? 8 of the things that he sees are man-made. Things that are there in nature, a God-made, horses, cattle, hills, plain, child, a tramp, and the river. Yes, these are all things of nature. The meadow, absolutely right. So you can do a listen and tabulate also. A listen and draw activity, again, another interesting activity. So now teachers, please grab your notepads and pens. We are going to do a little drawing activity. Thank you very much for your participation in the poem from a railway carriage. I hope you found this interesting and you will take it to your class. Do it with your students. Let's look at how we can do listen and draw. Please grab your notepads and pens. Yes. Thank you, Ms. Gurmeet. I'm glad you found this interesting. Thank you, Ms. Seema. Okay, teachers, I hope all of you have got your notepads and pens. All right. I'm going to give you some instructions and you have to follow my instructions. I understand we are not drawing teachers. We are English language teachers. I do not expect your drawing to be aesthetically beautiful. I only expect you to listen to my instructions carefully and draw, make your drawing as per the instructions given to you. Okay, so quickly, you have to make drawing as per my instructions. Right at the center of your page, draw a house with 2 windows and 1 door. Right in the center of the page, draw a house with 2 windows and 1 door. Behind the house, draw 3 mountains. Draw 3 mountains. On the roof of the house, draw a chimney. On the roof of the house, draw a chimney. Between the mountains, draw between the first and the second mountain, draw a sun coming up. On the third mountain, draw an apple tree. On the third mountain, draw an apple tree. On the right side of the house, draw a small pond. On the right side of the house, draw a small pond. In the pond, draw a small paper boat. Okay? All right, I hope everyone has finished making the drawing. I'm keeping it really short and not elaborating more on it. Some of you have already identified what I'm doing through this drawing. One, because all of you are involved, engaged in doing the drawing, you are all listening attentively. I have left no scope for you to look at me and pretend that you're listening and think about typically in a classroom and students, when you try to do a listening activity, you ask students to listen to you. They are all looking at you and you assume that they are all listening to you. But for all you know, they are thinking about what has mama given in the tiffin. Or when you do an online activity like this, they are wondering and they're thinking about what is coming up next. Is she going to finish on time? Yes. But to ensure that you participate in the listening, I am doing something. I am engaging you in a activity where you need to be doing something. And all of you did the drawing, and some of you very rightly have identified, Ms. Juhi has also done this activity in her class, and I'm sure, ma'am, you've seen how successfully you can teach various things using listen and draw. The part of speech that I used very frequently in my instructions. Yes? What was the part of speech? Right, Sadaf, I used a lot of prepositions. Yes, Anurag. Very good. I have all the English teachers putting up the right answer there. Yes, I used a whole lot of prepositions. In the center of the page, behind the house, on the roof, next to the house, in the pool, on the third mountain. So I used a whole lot of prepositions. Yes, absolutely right, Taranjeet. I also used a whole lot of nouns. House, chimney, pond, sun, mountains, apple, tree, whole lot of nouns also. I can, from this listening activity, I can ask students, make a list of all the things you have drawn. They will automatically list all the nouns. I can go on to teach nouns from here. I can ask them to write phrases. Where did you draw the house? In the center of the page. Where is the pond? Next to the house. So I can then teach them prepositions. And I'm teaching all of this in a very functional manner. So I can take a listening activity to teach different aspects of English language also. So listen and draw is interesting. Listen and do. Now this is specifically for doing words. Yes, when I want to do doing words, I usually do a listen and do activity where I am telling, I call out instructions and students have to do this. Raise your hands. Fold your hands. Point a finger on your nose. Can all of you do this as I call out these instructions? Put your notepads and pens down. Sit up. Okay. I'm not sure if I can see everybody's videos. Some of you whom I can see. Let's see you doing all of this. Okay. Listen and do. Hands up. Fold your hands. Pull your cheeks. How many of you are pulling your ears? I said pull your cheeks. You're pulling your ears. Okay, listen and do. This is, and I can see all of you smiling back at me now. Yes, thank you. This is a listen and do I do with the young learners, the younger students, even the senior students really enjoy this activity. In class, even in an online class, if you have your students with their videos on, it's an interesting icebreaker, energizer, and a listening activity. Yes, when you're teaching and it's integrated. When I'm doing it with the young learners, parts of the body, I do a whole lot of eye-hand coordination. I say, touch your cheeks. Now, children automatically go like this. And then I can pull, you know, I can have some fun. There's humor. It's interesting. It becomes interactive. Yes? So these are various listening activities that you can do in class to ensure that there is active listening going on. All right, let's look at the next skill, that is speaking in the class. How often do we give children an opportunity to speak in class? In a 40 minutes class, how much time do we allocate to speaking, students speaking, not teachers speaking? Frequently, okay, can we give some 10 to 15 minutes, all right? 15 minutes. Are all children speaking in the 15 minutes that we give? Supposing you have a class of 40 students. All 40 speak? No. Randomly. Yes? Randomly they are speaking. Out of 40, what is the percentage who may speak? Yes, Priya. Sometimes it's even just 5 or 10 minutes because we are doing a lot of speaking. How can a language classroom be successful unless STT is more than TTT? What is TTT and STT? In a language class, teachers, the STT should be more than TTT. Absolutely right, Ms. Anupriya. Teacher talk time should be less than student talk time. So we have to create opportunities for students to speak in class. We have to create opportunities for role play, discussions, debates. We need to teach children to speak with the right. Unless you allow children to speak, how can you guide them for the right accent, pronunciation, stress, and intonation? We need to create opportunities, create devise activities, and such activities that every student in the class is talking for at least 10 minutes. How can we do that? For example, all our students are sitting in rows. Yes? So you can say all the children in this, and you have 2 or 3 students in every desk, every bench. Yes? You can allocate in rows letters for the students. All of you sitting over here, you are A. Everyone in this row, on this side of the row, you are all B. So you do A, B, A, B to the row of students who are there before you. Now you say all the A's are, for example, all the A's are librarians and B's are students. Okay? You have to make a phone call. The student, that is all the B's, will make a phone call to the librarian, that is all the A's. The librarian has to answer the phone call. The student will make the phone call. The students, the simple task, and then you write the task on the blackboard. You write the task. You have to find out from the librarian how to enroll in the library, what are the timings, and how many books can be taken home at a time. Yes? So you've given them a broad script of what the conversation has to be. You've created a situation and you tell them, I'm giving you 30 seconds to prepare your script. Remember, teachers, English is a foreign language for all of our students. You cannot expect them to do extempore speaking. You can't give them an activity and ask them to suddenly start talking. Give them 30 seconds. 3 things you need to do. Call the librarian. Ask the librarian the process to enroll in the library. Ask her the timings of the library, the working hours of the library, and how many books can be taken home. You write this on the board, you've told them. Tell them, look at the questions and all the B's, that is the students, think of how you're going to ask all these things to the librarian, and all the A's, the librarians, will think of responses to the questions. At the end of 30 seconds, that's their preparation time, you say, okay, you blow a whistle, start. And you have all the A's, all the B's doing the call, making the call, and you can give them some props by doing tring, 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 tring. Come on, librarians, pick up the phone. Make it interactive. Make it interesting. You will find all the students smiling and pretending with their pencil boxes, with their books. They will hold a pencil box. I don't have a pencil box. I just have my moisturizer here. They'll hold it to their ears, whatever they have. I have a duster here. They'll hold it to their ears and they will try to make this call interesting. So you can create these situations, these opportunities. I have another activity here, which I have pulled out from the Magnolia again. It's an activity. Yes, and you give a time frame. Thank you so much, Eugene for that suggestion. You also give them a time frame. You have only 2 minutes to make this call. At the end of 2 minutes, you blow the whistle. Now, all of you who were students become librarians, who were librarians become students. You reverse it. You can create umpteen situations coming from the student's life. Okay, situations like one is a parent, the other is a child. Child has to ask permission from the parent to go on a class picnic or to go to a friend's house for a group study. You give them a situation, and in the Magnolia, in your speaking activities, I also found a whole lot of guidelines for speech. For example, what you find on your screen is how to speak politely, how to disagree politely. If someone says, I think you should pack the hamper, no, I won't. Now, that is rude. You can say the same politely. Sorry, I'm too tired. Can you please do it for me? Or will you please pack it for me? And then there are some more suggestions given how you can disagree politely. So now I can create a situation in class. I say all the A's are, all of you are yourselves, okay? All the A's want to go to the mall in the evening. The B's want to stay back at home and finish their homework. So B's have to politely say no to A's. Now these are situations that children are actually going through. How to say no to a friend. You're also teaching life skills while doing speaking activities. Yes, situation-based role play you're doing in your class. Fabulous, Sunil. That's what I find this is a very, very successful way of getting students to drop inhibitions about speaking in the English language. The more you do this, you will find more your students are speaking English among themselves. There's very often children are speaking in English only when the teacher enters the class. The minute you walk out of the class, they'll break into the local language. But if you want to encourage a lot of speaking English, when you do these role plays in class, you need to walk around, you need to tap on the back of these students and say, wow, well done, very good. At the end of it, you have to give your feedback to the class. I was walking around and I must say I am impressed. All of you are speaking so well. I would really like to see all of you speaking only English all the time in school. The children are motivated without even you realizing you are actually motivating students. When you do these small things like, you know, walking around, patting them on their back and saying, well spoken, well done, you're actually encouraging them to speak more. Reading in class. Reading in class, learn to predict questions first. Help children to infer what they've read. Help children to read with fun. I'm going to show you two reading things, reading activities that you can do with children. They are activities you will need to, participate in. I'm just trying to figure out how I can show my screen. I'm going to go in a full screen mode now and come back to the chat box after I finish sharing the screen. Okay, just give me a moment while I do this. Okay. All right, Father Varghese, can you see the PowerPoint on a full screen right now?
Yes, ma'am, please carry on.
Thank you. So when you do a read and predict, it can be something as simple as I show you a picture of Danny. I'm showing you three images right now on your screen. What you see on your screen are some arrows, a boy standing who's tied to a tree with an apple on his head, and there is another man with a bow and an arrow aiming somewhere. Who is Danny? I can't see the chat box while I do a full screen. I would request, I'm just going by recalling some of your names. Sadaf, who do you think is Danny?
Danny is the, hello, good morning, ma'am. I believe yes. Danny is the child standing in front of the tree with an apple on his head.
Okay. Sujita, what do you think? Sujita, can the man be Danny or can the person to whom the hand belongs, who's pulling out the arrow, could that be Danny? Sujita, what do you think? Or is Sebin there? I'm just trying to recall some of the names that I saw in the chat box. Can anyone else, maybe Gurpreet?
I think, ma'am, the man with the bow and arrow is
okay.
Danny.
All right. So you do this with your students in class, take in multiple answers. If time permits, you can elaborate, why can't the man pulling out the arrow be Danny? You know, so then you divert some children. Oh, yes, that's a possibility. That can be Danny. So you intrigue, you make them curious. Do you all want to find out? Do you really want to know who's Danny, children? What have I done? I've used a whole lot of predictions to inculcate curiosity. They are anxious. They want to know who is Danny. And now I say, okay, open your textbooks and just read the first sentence in your textbooks. The knights tied Danny to the oak tree. So who is Danny? The boy who's tied to the oak tree. The knights tied Danny to the oak, placed a red apple on his head and scattered. His father walked 100 paces away from the tree, turned, drew his long bow, aimed and released the arrow. So who is the man with the bow and arrow? Father of Danny. Now he's going to shoot. He aimed. Who is he going to shoot? You indulge in a whole lot of interaction, create curiosity. Do you think, let's read what happens next. Oh my God, it was a windy day. So what's going to happen when he shoots the arrow? What is the wind going to do to the arrow, children? This is how you create suspense. Danny saw the arrow coming fast and closed his eyes. Oh my God, will the arrow hit the apple? Will the arrow hit Danny? What's going to happen? Do you want to know, teachers? Do you want to know?
Yes.
Chat box and screen. Yes, do you want to know what happened to Danny?
Yes,
now, what I have done is I have intrigued all of you. All of you want to know what happens to Danny. Now I tell y'all all, go back to your textbooks, open your books, read the chapter. Yes, I'm not giving you the answer what happened to Danny. Those of you who want to know, go on Google and read the story of William Tell. This is the story of William Tell. I can't give you more because I will run short of time. So this is how you inculcate an interest for reading. This is something that works wonderfully with the young learners. Yes, you use the cliffhangers. Absolutely right, Sadaf. You use a whole lot of cliffhangers, curiosity, because I often tell this to teachers. Adults, all of us, we read because we want to read. I read the newspaper, I read a whole lot of blogs, I'm reading a whole lot of, I read novels off and on, 2-3 at a time sometimes, simultaneously. So we read because we want to read. Children read because they have to read. the textbook, the notebook, the workbook. They are reading because they have to read. As a language teacher, I am always striving to get children to want to read. And we have to create that situation to get children to want to read, even newspaper. I often go to class and tell children, I read this really interesting, you know, today's page 5 Times of India, this City News, they had this amazing thing about this little boy who did this, and I stopped. Those of you really want to find out what happened, go back home, read the paper. Tomorrow we'll talk about it. Yes? So we need to push children to want to read. Build cliffhangers is a fantastic way to take out small snippets. Using the newspaper to encourage reading is very, very useful. Even books, you need to make it exciting for children to want to read. Let's look at this reading activity. This is something I use in the senior students, with the senior students. The appointment in Samara. What do you think the story is about? What do you think the story is about? I'm getting a whole lot of feedback. I'm getting lots of more suggestions. And I'm so glad that these suggestions are publicly visible. So those of you who've been doing various things, the others can see from it. Okay, Shubhra, yes, the appointment in Samara is about an appointment. Who do you think the appointment is between? Who do you think the appointment is between? So the appointment could be between a doctor and a patient. The appointment could be between an employer and an employee. Now, I will wait. I'm not able to wait for all responses to come in because I will not finish all the skills if I do that. Yes, Sajita, the appointment can be between a principal and a parent. So the point, so I generate a whole lot of predictions from my students. I also ask them, what do you think is Samara? Is it a person? Is it a place? What do you think is Samara? Clearly, it's a place because the appointment is in Samara. Okay? All right. Then I read a part of the story for the students with a few dashes. Excuse me. Excuse me. There was a merchant in Baghdad who sent his servant to the market to buy provisions. And in a little while, the servant came back, white and trembling, and said, "Master, just now when I was in the marketplace, I was jostled by a woman in the crowd. And when I turned, I saw it was Dash that jostled me. She looked at me and made a threatening gesture." The servant continued, "Now, master, please lend me your horse and I will ride away from this city and dash. I will go to Samara and there she will not find me." The merchant lent him his horse and the servant mounted it. And he dug his spurs in his flanks and as fast as the horse could gallop, he went. Then the merchant went down to the marketplace and he saw her standing in the crowd. He came to her and said, "Why did you make a threatening gesture to my servant when he saw you this morning?" "That was not a threatening gesture," she said. "It was only a start of surprise. I was astonished to see him in Baghdad, for I had an appointment with him tonight in Samara." So, after I read this much with a whole lot of voice modulation and intonation, I ask the students, who is she? Who did the servant see in the marketplace? Who told the merchant that she did not threaten the servant? She was only astonished to see him in Baghdad because she had an appointment in Samara. Do you all want to know, teachers, who is she? Yes, 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 yes. A lot of yeses coming in there. Again, get back to the story, appointment in Samara, okay, and find out. Now, this is how I get children to want to read, okay? I'm not going to put so much load on y'all because after this session, I'm sure you'll have to prepare for a whole lot of your online classes. I will give you the answer. The dash was death and the appointment was of death. Yes, this is a very interesting story. The speaker is dead. This is the appointment in Samara as retold by W. Somersault Maugham. This is a very interesting story. And yes, you're curious now, Gurpreet. Good. I have a rendezvous with death. Yes, interesting ways to get children to want to read. We have to get creative and innovative to find interesting ways to get children to read. Coming to writing in the class. Yes, I would love to spend more time with each of these activities, but it's not possible because I understand to keep 188 people engaged for 1.5 hours online in a webinar is quite a challenge. And I'm sure all of us have many more other things to do post 11:30. So I'm going to try and stick to just doing sharing the activities, sharing the strategies, the teaching methodologies that you can take to classroom and to online teaching, the way I'm doing it with you right now. Writing in the class, yes, it's very difficult to get students to write, but what we can do is a lot of guided writing. Help students to write step by step, help them with vocabulary, spelling, ideas, sometimes only correct for one aspect of their writing. I've pulled up some examples over here, different classes, just to show you how this can be done. For example, class one, they're just learning the language. They've just come from senior KG, they're not sure if you can form sentences with them. So maybe give them parts and ask them to match to make complete sentence. I play a game. It cannot be I play a story. Can you play a story, children? You do this interaction with them, get them to make sensible sentences. You can also, with a little older children, this is an activity for class two, where you give them a letter format. We're teaching them letter in class two, but in such a simple way where you've given them the entire letter format with just the dashes. And the dashes are personal response dashes. So dear, write the name of your friend students. Now you're guiding children to a format of the letter. How are you? I hope you're enjoying the holidays. And then whatever dashes are there, the dashes are what the child wants to express. That's his personal response. So this is how you encourage students to write independently. With the little older children, class 4, 5, what I've pulled out are where they write a short story after they have finished reading a play in their textbooks. At the end of the play, They are asked to write the play as a short story. So what I'm also showing children is when you write a play, there's a script. So all the entire story of the play is written in the form of dialogues by the characters of the play. In between, you just have a narration or the setting is described in the balcony, in the forest, you know, that kind of a thing. Now, if I have to write it as a story, and I'm giving them scaffolding. I'm giving them guidelines how to write. You may begin like this. Winter was near. All the birds were flying south for warmth and food. So I'm giving them a setting. I'm giving, introducing the characters. The maple tree and oak tree were watching the flock of birds fly over them. And I've given them the dialogue in the story. So I've set the more of how a story has to be written, and I encourage children to now refer to the play in the book and convert it into a story. This is a class 4 activity. Class 5, I've given them an outline of a story and with a whole lot of, can you see the flow chart? There are different combinations that the children can write, make a story and write. So you need, if you want creative writing to go on well in your class, what we need to do is a lot of guided writing. Provide them the formats, provide them scaffolding. This is called scaffolding. When you give them a beginning, when you give them a flow chart indicating what they have to write, or when you give them guidelines, start with this, make sure you have included the below points, give them a few pointers, ensure this is how you end. It could be a letter, a story, an essay, a descriptive essay, narrative essay, whatever form, but you need to give them the template, the guidelines for it. Teaching vocabulary. Okay, let's quickly do this activity using the chat box. Teachers, get ready to type. Start typing in words that can be used to say talk. What words can be used to say talk? Speak, very good. Converse, excellent. Tell, say, comment. My God, it's going so fast now. Chat, say, mutter, whisper, scold, shout. These are all words we use for, which also mean talk. Yes? Is my screen still visible, teachers? I hope you're able to see the screen. Okay, give me more phrases for well done. Now, this is how I generate vocabulary in the class. Give me other words for talk, speak, whisper, mutter, shout, scold, comment, say, chat, converse. All of these come from all of you. You will find your students also responding. They may need a little encouragement. They may need a few examples, and then you'll find them all coming out. The minute they hear one person say whisper, someone else will say mutter, shout, scream. Yes, you will get the responses. Can I have some phrases similar to well done? Can you quickly give me more phrases similar to well done? My chat box has stopped moving. Teachers, can I see some responses there? I hope the screen is visible. I'm unable to see your responses.
Ma'am, I think it's a network issue because we are all sending the responses.
Oh, okay. Can you give me a few answers, ma'am? Thank you for speaking up. I'm really not able to see anything in the chat box. I think the screen is
frozen. Splendid. Splendid.
Splendid.
Bravo.
Bravo. Bravo.
Superb.
Keep it up.
Superb. Go ahead.
Excellent. Superb. Good job.
Perform very well.
Perform very well.
Go ahead.
Performed very well. Yes. Go ahead. Thank you so much. This is how we can do vocabulary. Okay. All right. The chat box is not working. I'm going to be at a great disadvantage because of that. I'm just going to share this activity. We will not be able to do that. I don't know how do I close this and open again? It's not happening. All right. Let's just move on. I'll just tell you the activity. I won't be able to do it because I can't see the chat box. I give them something like this, where I put in a word on the blackboard or I show it on the screen, depending on whether it's classroom or online. And I ask students, make more words using letters in the word that I put up on the board or screen. If it's the word is interesting, use the and interesting to make more new words. I'm sure a lot of you are already doing that. Now, this is a great way to do vocabulary. This is another game I wanted to play with you. Y'all can just give me the answers by unmuting your mics quickly. Dash, bite, and finish. Use a body part to complete the phrase. Example, you have kidney beans. I've used kidney, which is a body part, to complete the phrase kidney beans. You have to use another body part to complete the phrase dash biting finish. I'm sorry, I still can't see the chat box, so you all will have to just unmute and give me your answer.
Finger biting.
Nails. Lip smacking. Toe the line. Okay, I will quickly share the answers here because it's difficult to do an interactive activity without the chat box. 104 participants. Yes. Nail biting finish, toe the line, eye opener, nose dive, tongue twister, yeah. Water chestnut, cutthroat competition. Can you all see my screen? I hope the screen is visible.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, teachers. So this is how you can do a whole lot of vocabulary activity. Punctuation. Simple things like in class, your book, John, that's a question. And when I say your book, John, that's a statement. Yes? Let's eat grandpa. When I say let's eat grandpa, let's eat grandpa. When I say let's eat grandpa, I'm asking grandpa to join me to eat. And this last one is quite a favorite among teachers. Where you're going to put the punctuation marks. A woman without a man is nothing. Do you like that? Or do you like a woman without her man is nothing? Yes? You will have
the second one.
The second option.
All the female teachers will like the second one. And the first one. Yes?
Yes.
This is how you can introduce punctuation and the importance of punctuation.
Right.
Last thing before I start taking questions. This is a beautiful letter and it shows how a punctuation can completely twist the objective of the letter. I'm reading out, the content is the same. The text is exactly the same. I'm going to read out the first letter and you're going to tell me what the letter expresses. Dear John, I want a man who knows what love is all about. You are generous, kind, thoughtful. People who are not like you admit to being useless and inferior. You have ruined me for other men. I yearn for you. I have no feelings whatsoever when we are apart. I can be forever happy. Will you let me be yours? Gloria. So what is Gloria doing in this letter? She's expressing
her desire.
Her love desire for the man.
Her desire for love. Absolutely right. It's a really cute love letter.
Love letter, expressing
a love for John. Now look at the next letter. The words are exactly same. Punctuation marks have changed. Dear John, I want a man who knows what love is. All about you are generous, kind, thoughtful people who are not like you. Admit to being useless and inferior. You have ruined me. For other men, I yearn. For you, I have no feelings whatsoever. When we are apart, I can be forever happy. You let me be yours, Gloria. What's the second letter?
She's complaining. This is a hate letter. Breakup letter.
The question is a breakup love letter. It's a letter of rejection.
Yes.
So you see how punctuation marks make a huge difference. Importance of teaching punctuation. Yes, we need to teach punctuation and you can take this. These are examples as per level of the students, you can take it to class. Something like this, fun, funny things. Let's eat grandpa, your book, John, he was bitten by a dog which hurt him. These are sentences you can take to your primary and middle school primary students. A woman without a man, middle school. 6th, 7th, 8th students will find it interesting. Something like this, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th. Yes, just to lay emphasis on the importance of punctuation in writing. I'm going to move to questions and recap. Okay, and I don't know how we will do without the chat box. I'm just going to quickly try logging out and coming back in again. Just give me 2 minutes while I do that. Hopefully the chat box will begin. And while I do that, y'all can start putting down your questions and
yes, ma'am. Dear participants, you can type in your queries here. As we wait for Smila ma'am to come back, you may please type in your queries.
All right, I am back. I have joined back. Please type in your questions. Have you all started typing in, teachers? Because I am not seeing the questions here. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much, Ms. Sadaf. One of the best webinars I've attended. Enjoyed thoroughly, learned new things and recalled old ones. Thank you so much. It is difficult to get senior class students get interested in language. They're lazy enough to write. How to motivate them? We need to make the topics of the writing activities relevant to the students as per their age. You need to take topics which they can relate to, topics they can talk about. We often stick to topics we have grown up with, you know, a rainy day, first day of school. We need to start changing those topics. They have to be more relevant. Make it interesting for students to want to speak about. Yes, you can ask them to, what are your thoughts? You can take up current issues with the older, with the senior students, current issues. Write an essay of what you think about what is an equivalent to racism in India. Right now you're having the entire social media world is going on and on about what happened to George Floyd. Yes. This is a good time to ask children to write, you know, and again, it's integrated study. It's integrated study. They are writing and you're also then pushing them to start reading up. They'll have to read the newspaper to know what is happening. Or, George Floyd, if too much of a global news, let's stick to some local news. Write an essay maybe when you start your online classes again. The one thing that I missed the most during lockdown, or your topic, your essay topics can be three things that I'm going to do as soon as school reopens. You have to give something to connect with. They have to be motivated to want to be reading about it. Yes. Any other questions? Thank you so much, teachers. I'm really encouraged, and it's heartening to see all the lovely feedback. How can we apply this strategy of not using mother language when we are in a locality where kids from lower middle? Yes. Ms. Punyavati, this is a challenge I faced when I was running my own pre-primary school in Mumbai. Now, Mumbai is a metro, despite everything else. We do have a lot of our students, and over here, really, the economic background doesn't matter. I do have children who come from very affluent families, but English is not the spoken language. It's Gujarati, Marwadi, the mother tongue. And children are all coming from homes where English is not the spoken language. However, that you need to stick to your grounds of speaking in English. Use a lot of body language. Sit down, everybody. Open your books. Open your books. Take out your books. You need to do a whole. You may find it funny in the pre-primary section, or even in the middle school. In primary school, you may find it very funny where you're doing this like a robot, doing so much of body language. But trust me, it works. At the end of the day, your children are going back with a whole lot of English in their heads. Because please understand, when they go back home again, they have no exposure to English. They get back to their mother tongue. The only exposure to English they have is when they come to you. And even there, if you're going to give them exposure to mother tongue, the brain is not grasping. The brain is not picking up any English. So we need to use articles, use real objects, use flashcards, get pictures, images to class. Show that through and use voice modulation. Quickly, stand up quickly. Then you know, the children know quickly means, see, even if someone doesn't know the language, if I say, big untule, do you all remember what untule meant? How many of you remember what untule meant? Put it in the chat box. Untule materla, stand up. Yes, Miss Neelam, I could see your lips. Stand up. And big untule is fast, quickly. So use voice modulation, intonation, a whole lot of these things. Yes? Okay, I'm just looking for some more questions now. Thank you so much, Ms. Punyavati, that you find the session boosting. Thank you. These are all, thank you so much for all the feedback. So Father, I think most of the questions I have answered, and what I see here is feedback. Okay, I have a question. How to teach long English lessons without reading line by line and explaining them? Questions first. Okay, what you do is you make a list of questions and you ask children to do silent reading in class. It's not possible that you can get them to skip any part of the lesson. But yes, you can get them to do silent reading in class by first posing about 10, 15 one-line answers. Who, what, when, where? Put those questions, get them to read, and maybe you can take it paragraph-wise. The first two paragraphs read, these are the questions 1 to 5. Those who can finish, fine. Raise your hand when you finish reading the first two paragraphs and for these questions. So there is a race in class to read. Silent reading, children are pushed, they are competing with one another. Healthy competition, at the same time, you're meeting your objective of getting students to read in class. So you can do that. Ideas for improving handwriting, practice, practice, practice. That's the only way, children, the more you write, the better you write. Yes? Thank you so much, Ms. Bindu. Thank you, Sumi. Thank you, everyone. Okay. Father, I think most of the questions, I am sharing my email ID in the chat box. Just if you have any more questions, feel free to mail me your questions. You want activities, you can mail. I'll be happy to share it with you. Yes. Thank you very much for being a wonderful person. Back to Father Vargas. Yes.
Ma'am, Suma Joseph had a post-play query. Now the students, they mix up English, both the American version as well as the British English. So how to correct them?
I'm sorry, Father. Can you please repeat your question?
Madam Suma Joseph had posted this query. Nowadays, students use combination of British and American English. How to handle
it? Foremost, students need clarity on the difference between British English and American English, and students need to be told that the English they have learned is British English. So in British English, we don't say schedule, we say schedule. I hear a lot of teachers even using schedule because we've heard a lot of it in the Hollywood films. Yes, and I always stick to schedule, and very often teachers are wondering, She's not saying it right, but schedule is the British English, and we need to take this to the students also. When we hear students saying or using the American version of the English, we need to tell them we speak the Queen's language. The English that was given to India came from the British. What we use in our textbooks, what we use in our spellings, color we say with a U and not C-O-L-O-R. That's the American color. We use the British English. So this is, if you're speaking English in the Indian way, you need to use the British English. So we say schedule and a whole lot of other words. That's the only way, Father, you can get them. But yes, of course, despite that, the vocabulary, the language is all getting Americanized. Recently, one of my students told me, wow, ma'am, what a sick webinar. And I was crestfallen, heartbroken. And I said, what do you mean? I tried so hard to make it interesting. No, ma'am, we enjoyed it. How sick webinar. No, it means it was great. Their whole communication is changing these days, the young people. We have to catch up with it. But yes, as an English teacher, I keep trying to tell them. And they're saying things like, oh, shit, man, it was so... And I have to tell them, you know, it makes me feel like it was bad. You don't use this vocabulary for this. Their entire, the way they define vocabulary, yes, Father, it has changed. We can only keep... getting back and telling them that this is the right way, but there's no control over it. They are going to the exposure that they're getting. And today, thanks to Netflix and Amazon, there is so much of American content that our students are watching. It's very, very difficult. And they're at that age where they're easily influenced. So they just try to repeat that. But we have to stick to our grounds and see who can be a bigger influence. The teacher or the media. Yes.
Kindly stay tuned in for a couple of minutes more. I call upon Vanshila Imson of MGM High Secondary School, Dimapur.
Yes. Very good morning to one and all. I'm Vanshila from MGM School, Dimapur. Unprecedented situation, all the participants for actually participating and making this such an enjoyable and satisfying learning experience. Let's all come together for the benefit of our children. So thank you one and all, and have a great day.
Thank you, dear Smita ma'am, and all the participants for your wonderful participation in today's webinar. Let's hope that all the learning that you have taken will be translated into the classrooms. Thank you.